I welcome the Chief Guest, Dr. Jayakrishnan. Special thanks to Dr. Preeta for bringing such an eminent personality to our webinar. And congratulations to the Department of Physics for organizing their first webinar during this lockdown period. So when Sir came up with so many titles, the solid state devices attracted me because even we say science, technology, all those things, the basic of science is very much required for an engineer or a technologist, and the solid state devices plays a major role. So that is what is my understanding. So I thought it would be very apt even for the first year engineering students, ENT students, to know what it is, what is solid state devices, and how it is going to be implemented in engineering and technology. So I think the topic is very apt. And I thank Dr. Jayakrishnan for immediately accepting our response and coming here. I hope you have so many technical issues, but still thank you, sir. And I request all the participants to take home what he's telling and work on it and then give some output. For example, why I'm telling this is now many first year students, they have got many ideas, or many students, they've got ideas, and there are so many fundings available for the students. So all these type of events will help them to grab the ideas, take the concept of science and make it into a reality, which is the technology. So this should be your takeaway message from this webinar, right? So thanks to the organizers for giving me an opportunity. And once again, I welcome the Chief Guest for this program. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. And now it's time to know about our speaker, a Chief Guest. Over to Dr. Preeta for introducing our Chief Guest.
Thank you, Lata ma'am. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am delighted to introduce our guest of the day, Dr. R. Jayakrishnan, Associate Professor, Department of Physics, Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala. A great academician, a young scientist who made great achievements in the field of solar cells, thin films, laser spectroscopy, analytical instrumentation, imaging, cryogenics, material characterization, his educational qualification. He has completed his doctorate in philosophy in 2009. He has obtained his Master's of Science in Physics in 2002 with third rank. He has completed his Bachelor of Science in Physics in 2000. His professional experience. He has more than 12 years of experience in industry, academia, research, and consultancy. His area of research, surface photovoltaic phenomenon, photoconduction mechanisms, photovoltaic device structures, clean water, materials and devices for artificial intelligence. Consultancy. He acts as a consultant in thin film coatings, core banking solutions, hospital management systems. His awards and achievements. He is a recipient of Melpadam Attimalil George Kutty Young Scientist Award in 2019. He received his certificate award for his outstanding contribution in reviewing Journal of Sensors and Actuators by Elsevier in 2017. He is a recipient of Kerala State Young Scientist Award in 2015. He is awarded by Teacher Summer Research Fellowship from Indian National Science Academy in 2010 and in 2012. He received Senior Research Fellowship from Council of Scientific and Industrial Research in 2007. He was elected as a member of the Institute of Physics, London, and he has published a book entitled Photoconductivity for Beginners in 2012. And he has received patent for the work in dielectric coatings for efficiency improvement in carbon silicon solar cells. On behalf of Department of Physics, first year ENTS, Dr. MGR Educational and Research Institute University, I extend a warm welcome and request Dr. R. Jayakrishnan to take up the session. Over to you, sir.
What is happening? Like, we have two failures just now happened. I think next half an hour at least, we shouldn't have any power problems here. I hope the presentation is visible to all of you, right?
Yes, sir. It is visible.
Yes, sir.
presentation visible, right? Okay. So I think I will start off. At the outset, I would like to thank the Faculty of Engineering Technology of the Dr. MGR Educational and Research Institute for having invited me as a speaker for their national webinar. I would also like to thank my friend Dr. Preeta, who actually remembered to call me up for this. So good afternoon to all of you. The title of my talk today is Band Theory of Solid State Devices. Now, see, we are all stuck in our own places and we are enjoying a lot of things. And all this enjoyment is at the cost or is only because of the existence of working solid state devices. Now the heart, now I put up a few science fiction characters on the front page. Say the Terminator. Terminator was a science fiction, say 20 years back. But today we have achieved instruments or machines which can actually replicate everything that the Terminator was conceptualized to show. Now, what is the heart of all these instruments is basically nothing but solid state devices. So that is where the power of solid state lies in. So I'll start with this quote by Albert Einstein, who said that you don't really understand something unless you can explain it to your grandmother. Now you see, any of these smart devices that we use today, even my grandmother is capable of using it. So it is the advent of technology that actually enabled us to adapt to any of these changes which are taking place. But the word that I use is technology. But the heart of technology is actually science. And that is where I feel India is backward. Now, way back in 1901, Jagdish Chandra Bose took the patent. He's basically a physicist who was working in Presidency College. When he was working there, he took up the patent for something which is called as a cat whiskers, a semiconductor device which can actually pick up radio signals. Now, as a physicist, he took up the patent, but then it didn't go forward. The patent actually paid off to somebody else. Like the Americans were fast to recognize the potential of this particular patent that he had taken, and they put their lab people into work there. It was from the AT&T lab that they came up with a number of materials which could do the same thing what Bose had actually done. Like Bose had obtained the patent for using.
Sir, excuse me, one second, sir. Sir, one second. I think somebody else is presenting. One second, somebody else is presenting. Gijo is somebody. Andal, madam, please check whether you are able to see our screen and that same thing is recorded. Somebody has presented now.
Actually, I can't do the stop presenting by myself.
No, you can. Maybe you can switch the window on again, see whether Sar's presentation is there.
Sar's presentation is there, madam.
No. You will be able to see Andal, but I want it in the recording. Somebody presented after he came out. So what you do, just switch Sar's face window over what you click on, then again click his presentation.
Okay, ma'am.
Face window click on it, ma'am. See that nobody else is presenting in your screen. Then again, you click Sar's presentation screen.
Now we are all seeing his presentation, ma'am.
Okay. Now you switched, no?
I clicked his presentation, ma'am.
Okay. Now go ahead, sir. You can go ahead, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Technology and its advancements, right? So I think I was talking about AT&T.
Sir, excuse me, sir. Sorry to bother you.
Yeah.
Sir, you can show as a slideshow, sir, so that your screen will be bigger enough.
Okay. Is it more visible now?
No, sir. It's same as earlier.
I think it is picking up only the screen. It is not picking up the slideshow screen.
But, you can press F5, you can do.
Sir, press F5, sir.
Yeah, my my show is actually on my system.
No, yours is visible, but we want a full screen.
Right
now, you are able to see your screen.
I think. Now you're able to see my screen?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, yes, screen is visible, sir. Okay, sir, continue, sir. Continue.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
Now it is a full screen.
Yes, it is visible. It is visible.
Okay. Oh, what I was saying was the AT&T company actually took up the patent, but they worked on silicon actually. And they ended up building the first silicon film. But the patent again went to one of the workers at AT&T who established his own company, and by 1945 the company was established. Now all those silicon based rectifiers that we handle is actually a part of that patent which was developed. What I was actually saying is science is one end, the technology is at the other end. So somebody takes a patent for something, some technologists have to come forward to take up to find new applications. Now what is the advantage? Solid state devices. See, today there are a lot of research works going on into nanotechnology, etc. But then, as on date, only solid state devices are being used for the industry because of three basic things: performance, reliability, and cost effectiveness. These three things are the core of what the semiconductor industry is today. Like, though there are a lot of technologies in the lab which is going on, unless somebody comes up with the actual technology which can beat a semiconductor device in these three areas, none of them are going to get replaced in the next decade at least. So if you look at the solid state device, it actually comes from, say, basics of physics, where I've actually picked up a lot of areas where actually all the state of solid state comes into. Now, semiconductor properties and the solid state electronics is one branch of science or one branch of physics which actually goes in depth into this. Whereas the other part of it is that you have to study the electrical properties, and that is where actually the band theory comes into play. So it is actually the band theory which controls the electrical properties, which actually controls the solid state, which controls the semiconductor properties, which enables us to design solid state devices actually. So when you plan of having a device, you can think about designing devices for different applications. Now here, what I've just picked up is, if you're thinking about communication devices, now this is the range of frequencies that you have to work about. You have, say, the audio frequencies, you have the amplitude modulated waves, you have the FM waves. Mm. So based on the frequencies that you have to work, you have to pick up your material. Similarly, if you are thinking about working with, say, power applications, you have to think about what kind of power you're thinking of delivering. So based on what is the application, we have to go for designing of our materials and designing of our devices accordingly. Now, why do we believe in band theory of solids? See, basically, the band theory of solids was accounted to explain the decrease in resistivity with increase in temperature, as well as the concept of band gap in materials. So in order to account for such a model, physicists had to use quantum mechanics again. So when, as a science graduate or a science postgraduate, once you understand, I think the echo is over, I guess.
Mr. Somebody called Jenny, please mute your mic.
I'm just trying to give you an idea. One of the common questions that can come is, why is sodium a conductor? To explain this, I've actually used this our band theory and I'm trying to explain that. That is what would be my major idea today. If you look at sodium, the structure is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2. These are actually the available electronic states in its configuration. Whereas if you look at the available electrons, it is actually like in the 3s state, you have the outermost. So let us imagine that you place a sodium atom here, as I will seen in the diagram. And you also have a sodium atom is placed here. Now, if you think of bringing these two sodium atoms together, bring them closer together. Now, to understand what happens when they come together, we think about physics. That is where actually science actually goes into play. We actually have a mathematical formulation having a wave function representing each of these electrons. Now, that is actually represented as psi A and psi B in the figure. Now, if you imagine psi A to be representing the wave function of this outermost electron here, and psi B representing the electron here, what will happen if you start placing these two atoms closer together? If you bring these two atoms closer together, we can expect two things. So, these are the two things that we actually anticipate here. In case the atoms are symmetric, they will add together and you will actually find out the atom, here one atom, here one atom. And actually this blue line actually shows us a mathematical representation of finding the opposite electron somewhere. Whereas if you look at this, this is actually in the anti-symmetric case. In this case, still the atom is here. But still, mathematically, that is a position where the probability of finding the electron is actually zero here. So this is actually the most important mathematical conclusion based on the calculation of the quantum mechanics. Say that there is a probability that you place these two atoms together, there is definitely a region where you can end up with having no electrons at all. To explain this is where actually the time theory actually goes further. Now, what I have done actually here is, I have imagined I am placing six of these sodium atoms like this. Say first one, second one, third one, fourth one, fifth one, sixth one. So each of these atoms have their wave functions here. Now, if you look at what will happen to the energy states. So what will happen here, we have six 1s states, six 2s states, which actually will become 12 again. 12, here, six, 36 states. So, what happens here is that as the number of atoms keep on increasing, that is, the possible energy states keep on increasing. So if you further increase it, and say this is one isolated atom here, this is actually two of the atoms which are brought together. This is actually six of those atoms brought together, and imagine this is n of the atoms brought together. So what actually happens for a single isolated atom where we have 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, when n of these atoms are brought together, you have 2 into n, 2n, again 2 into n, 2n, 6 into n, 6n. What is the 6n, 2n, 2n here actually?
Sir, Jayakrishnan sir.
Yeah.
One second, I think your PPT is not moving, sir. It is in the same slide, I believe.
One minute.
Yeah.
Is it moving now? You able to see?
Sir, Andal, you are presenting. Andal, just come out. Let me just check, sir.
Move to my next slide. Can you see the next slide? This slide? I'm moving my slides.
Sir, it is in the 19.1 semiconductor rectifier patented. That's the only we are able to see.
Is that visible?
No.
That is not visible.
Yeah, it's moving, sir.
Now we are able.
Yes, now it's right now.
It's moving now. You are showing some table, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, sir, you can continue.
Okay. I think I will repeat that once more then. I think you are able to see this slide where I've actually shown one isolated atom, two interacting atoms, six interacting atoms, and n interacting atoms, right? Yeah, you're able to see, right? So if you imagine two of these atoms here. Now, earlier, as I said, we have to think about one as symmetric and the other as antisymmetric. So if you look at this position as the symmetric and the other as the antisymmetric, only when two of these atoms are brought together, as they come together, your potential energy states can interact with each other. So what happens when your potential energy states interact? You have two of these atoms interacting, you have n number of these atoms interacting. So with n number of atoms interacting, you're going to end up having n number of states in space. Now, this was actually what Kroning and Penny actually modeled as an approximation, where instead of having the energy states as bent potentials, they actually imagine them to be perfectly square well potentials. Now, in a square well potential, the concept that they used was an atom is inside the well, and the electron actually can move from one end of a crystal to the other end of the crystal by passing through these potential wells. Now, there is a little bit of mathematics here, which I will not go into much of details here, but the theory or the mathematics actually solves the wave functions for an electron which actually moves from one end of a crystal to the other end of the crystal, assuming that this is a perfect rectangular potential well. Whereas in practice and actual materials, it will not be rectangular. It will be actually then something like a spherical, or it will be something like parabolic. It depends upon the kind of materials that you handle. So what they did was they set up the differential equations, solved the differential equations, and came up with a relation connecting the wave functions and the energy. Now, this is standard equations, but the important solution that these derivations actually come to is that, now in a normal case, if you draw the energy versus K diagram, you would expect the energy to be parabolic in nature. Whereas if you use the approximation that the potential wells are periodic in nature, then you actually end up with energy diagrams which are not perfectly parabolic but broken. Now, what is this broken state? Actually, it is again mathematics, which is that they actually plotted a probability of finding out the electron. Probability of finding out the electron. In this figure, if you look at this, wherever the dotted lines actually cross these blue regions, these blue.
Sorry, sorry to bother you. The screen is not again moving, sir.
My screen is not moving again?
Yeah, it's not showing the parabola.
Okay, I think that should have messed up. Okay, the figure should not be. Now, is the screen moving anyway?
No, sir.
No.
Now it's moving. Actually, it should be at 14th slide, sir.
14th slide, okay.
Yeah.
Come to my 14th slide. Oh.
At parabola.
This, here. I think I crossed this. You're able to see screen right now?
Yeah, it's moving.
Now the full screen?
Yeah.
Okay. So what I was saying is that, see, if normal case, if you expect that all this mathematics is not followed, if you plot the energy versus the K diagram, you are expected to get a perfect parabola. But this is not actually what is observed, basically because if you go into quantum mechanics or you solve the Schrodinger's equation, you end up with a situation where there is no probability of finding out the electron in these blue shaded regions. These blue shaded regions do not show any probability of finding out electron. Now, when that is translated into your three-dimensional material, what happens is you have to have an EK diagram which actually is broken wherever the electron was not feasible to be found. So that region, such regions are where they actually called as band gap of the material. Now, such breaks are there for all different values, for many different values of the lattice constants. So if you look at a band structure, everywhere where you find there is space between two of these states, that is 1s, 2s, 2p, 3s, 2, 3p6, such states always would be broken in the EK diagram, that is non-continuous or discontinuous EK diagrams. Now, this is the diagram which actually you'll have to understand more clearly, which is actually only for carbon, which is like different states of carbon states, which shows that all of these parabolic bands actually mix with each other. I've just picked up this diagram, but I will tell in detail with respect to sodium, because the same thing happens in sodium, and this explains why sodium is a conductor. Now, if you go back and see these bendings, what happens here is that for sodium, the 3s states and the 3p states, they bending actually causes the 3p state to mix with the 3s state. Now, 3s state, as you are aware, in sodium has only one electron in the outermost orbit, whereas the 3p state is the conduction state. So 3s to 3p transition can take place with very small amounts of energy, which means that basically sodium becomes a conductor even without the absence of giving a huge electric field. Just in the presence of small electric field, the electrons in the partially filled 3s states are able to transfer themselves to the completely empty 3p states, which means that it will show conducting behavior. So technically, it is these transition of electrons from states, what we normally call as valence bands to conduction band, basically transition from a state 3p or 3s states to 3p states, or from p states to d states or d states to f states. Such transitions are the ones which actually help improve the conductivity of any material. Now I'll come to the basics of a semiconductor actually. Now you know that we think of the semiconductor as a black box, because when you make a device, we don't have to be bothered about what the actual material is made up of. And we all know that you imagine that the conduction band is completely empty, whereas the conduction band is completely empty and the valence band is completely filled. Now, in order to say that it will conduct, such a material will conduct, what is required is an electron from the valence band should move into the conduction band. And once it is free in the conduction band, it will show some kind of conductivity. Now, based on this understanding, silicon is one of the most widely explored materials, basically because the band gap of silicon is only around 1.0 nanometers. Now, and the Fermi level, which is actually in the world, it takes just 300 Kelvin to push an electron from the valence band to the conduction
sir,
band.
Sorry to interrupt you. Again, Jason, sir?
Yeah, stuck again.
It's not scrolling, sir.
This is visible now?
Yeah, it's visible, sir.
This is visible?
Yes, sir.
This is visible now?
Sir, we are in intrinsic semiconductor slide.
Correct. Okay, yeah. Thank you. Yeah, so if you look at this intrinsic semiconductor of silicon, now in the pure form of the silicon, the band gap is only 1.09 electrons.
Excuse me, sir?
Yeah.
Sir, could you please put it in slideshow? I mean, full screen, it will be better to see.
That is what actually I'm not able to understand, because in my computer, this is running on full screen actually.
Sir, actually, have you put it on from current slides? There is an option top left corner.
Yeah, at the bottom.
So you have already got that.
Yeah, that is already live actually.
Okay, so it's some network issues. Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you. Right now, this is actually in my show mode actually. Okay, the screen on my laptop is showing as a show mode. Okay, so in case of silicon, if you look at this, what I was saying is that it just requires room temperature for pushing an electron from the valence band to the conduction band. Whereas for some other semiconductors, this room temperature is not sufficient at all. If you look at germanium, the band gap is again only 0.72 electron volt. So basically, this band gap, what we see is the distance between these two states. Say it can be the minimum distance between these two states for the electron to move from one shell to the other. This we call the band gap of a material. It will vary in different materials on different states actually. This is just a basic thumb rule where I would like to say is that, see, for a material, any material, what we have learned is that if it is purely intrinsic material, the Fermi level would lie exactly at the center of the conduction band and the valence band. Now, if you imagine that you start doping the material, now if you dope the material with, say, an N-type dopant, the Fermi level would actually move the conduction band. Whereas if you dope it with a p-type material, it will move into the valence band. Now this picture here is actually just to show you that the effect of temperature. If temperature causes the electrons to be pushed from the valence band to the conduction band. Now normally what will happen, the effect of temperature will cause the electron to reach the conduction band and the Fermi level would actually also go along with it. So, in case of a pure intrinsic material, if it is kept at absolute zero, you can actually expect that none of the electrons have reached the conduction band and the Fermi level is exactly at the center. Whereas for any other temperature, what would happen is that the Fermi level will be at a higher position than the exact center. So, this, with that actually, I'll actually move into some basics of making a device. Now, when you think about making devices, as I said, you'll have to think about doping. And when doping comes into play, the Fermi level actually moves. This diagram actually is showing a donor level and an acceptor level here. Now, what happens when you have two of these materials which are placed next to next? Now, this is what actually I'm trying to show here. If you have two materials, this is one material, this is another material, you have all the fully filled states exactly opposite to each other. Now, if you place them next to next and have a contact on both the sides, the flow of electrons would be impossible, basically because you have only filled states opposite to each other. Whereas in this figure, if you see, you have filled states opposite to empty states, which means if you have connections or you have electrical contacts on the opposite sides, you are anticipated to see the flow of electrons from filled state to empty state. This is one possible way that you can actually design a material. You can also design a material where you can have partial alignment. That is, you can have a fully filled state and you can have a partially overlapping empty state lying next to your material. So such kind of alignment, here you can actually see empty state lying opposite to two states. That is, you have the possibility that the electron can move into this, the electron can move into this also. So how the energy bands are aligned results in different kinds of materials and devices. And solid state devices are completely controlled by these kinds of properties. The most important property would be the energy gap, then the doping, then the mobility, then its lifetime, the conditions under which the material is going to work, like the temperature, the condition of illumination, and the characteristic that you can actually take out of the device, that would be as a DC device or as an IC device.
Sorry to interrupt. Again, the slide is not moving, sir.
I think that is getting hung. The title of my, this should be material properties. Is
that
visible?
Yeah.
Okay. So when we start making a device, we have to think about what is the energy gap of the material, what is the level of doping in the material, what is the mobility in the material, what is the carrier lifetime in this material. So these four properties actually would control a lot of electrical properties. The ambient condition under which the equipment is working or the device is working would be like a temperature or illumination. Now these two together would control the terminal characteristics of the device, as the IV properties under DC condition or the AC condition or transient conditions. Actually, the entire thing would take again 2 hours of talk if I go into details. But these are the thing, or these are the properties that we have to understand when we decide the kind of device that we got to make. So we'll simply look at the diode, which is the most simplest of the solid-state devices. So all of you are familiar with this IV characteristic, where you actually have a p-type material and you have an n-type material. Now, it can also be possible, or it is commonly seen, that you take intrinsic silicon, you dope that silicon to p-type, and then you dope a small portion as n-type and make a p-n junction out of it. This is the IV characteristic that is exhibited by it. Now, this kind of IV characteristic, when it is exhibiting, what we need to understand is what is happening at the band level of it. So, in the case of a simple diode, at the band level, when you apply a potential, when you apply a potential across the diode, what happens is that the bands get aligned in such a way that what happens is that the filled states get aligned against the empty states, so that the transfer of electrons can take place easily from the valence band to the conduction band, which actually results in flow of current in the forward direction when you apply a voltage. Whereas you won't find a current in the reverse direction, basically because what happens is that this is the alignment. You have filled states in only empty states, which does not allow the flow of current. Whereas as you keep on increasing the reverse bias voltage, you may end up to states where you have empty states coming across filled states, which allows a rapid flow of current. So after this region, you can actually anticipate a breakdown in current. The same phenomenon actually happens when you go to a transistor also. You have the forward characteristic you in the input as well as the output. So any of these IV characteristics that these devices actually exhibit is actually a reflection of the kind of band alignment that is taking place. Now, this is the band alignment that normally that is happening in the material. I just took normally this as a break because I just didn't want the confusion there. Okay. Now, if you look at this diagram here, see, when you put a p-type material across an n-type material, earlier we were talking about having the this is the, say, imagine this is the valence band, this is the conduction band for p-type material, n-type material. You put them together, normally we would anticipate that it is two bricks which are placed next to next. But in actual situation, it will be in the form of a step. Now, from where does this step actually come into place? So this step actually comes into place basically because, see, when they come into contact, when you place two of these materials into contact, that is bound to happen, diffusion of electrons actually take place, or diffusion of electrons and holes in order to obtain an. So when that takes place, what will happen is, from the n-type side, where the electron density is higher, there is a flow of electrons to the p-side, whereas in the p-side, where the hole density is higher, there is a flow of electrons to the n-side. Ultimately, there will be an equilibrium which is taking place in this region. Now, I think you would have learned that to be the dead layer here, or this is actually where you actually will not find any charged species. So in where there is no charged species, the potential will be lower. That is why actually we actually draw a slope here, because of no potential in this dead region. The same thing can happen when you start applying a field actually. When you apply a field, what happens? Now, you have already made a p-n junction. Next, you apply a field so that you push electrons from one side to the other. Now, when you start pushing electrons from one side to the other, you have to actually, the applied field reduces this step size. This potential is over, which enables the electron to move and the hole to move. So it can happen either under a zero bias, under a reverse bias, or under a forward bias. In three cases also, whatever is happening is the application of an electric field. So when you think about a bias condition as a forward bias or reverse condition, the application of the field causes the charges to be transferred across the junction, so that the junction which is actually dead has no potential, and the flow of electrons actually from one side to the other results in a inbuilt field there. Now, to overcome this field, it has to have either you have to apply a greater potential, or it can also be so some of the materials will respond in a different way. I will come to that in the next few slides. So either in the forward direction or in the reverse direction, in order to make the electron flow from one side to the other side, remember that it is actually moving from one of the p states or s states to another p state or s state. That is where actually we have to transfer the energy. Now I'll actually share some of these simple three or four slides where we have actually made some of these devices. Now, like two of these materials, we have actually done this. These are my actual research works where they use simple copper substrates onto which we have deposited p-type coppers of cupric oxide, on which we have done n-type indium sulfide, onto which we have actually done silver electrodes. Now, this electrode here is before doing the electroding, we have done something which is called as texturization. Instead of having this material, it is textured so that when you have the IV characteristic, see, this is actually for the non-textured surface. This black dot is for the non-textured surface, and this spot is for the textured surface, which shows that there is an increase in current as you texture it. So this is the IV characteristic. This is actually in the fourth quadrant, actually. So it actually shows that texturing actually can increase the current in the fourth quadrant. Now, working in the fourth quadrant is important from the concept of a photodiode, or it can also be used as a source. It can work in the fourth quadrant. Similarly, we were talking about, say, having multiple layers. We talked about two junctions earlier. Now I'm talking about, say, you have a glass substrate which is non-conducting. You have an SnO2 layer. You have a CuO. You have an nano indium sulfide layer, and then an indium sulfide layer, and on top of it, you have a silver layer. Now, what happens when you go into nano regimes? This is how the IV characteristic comes into play. Now, normally, what would you expect? You would expect a linear IV here. Now, this is one of the interesting results that we could obtain, where since you have nano layer here, what should happen to its band states? So some of these band states would actually prevent electrons to flow further. Some of the band states in this layer would prevent electrons to flow further, which avoids growth of current. That is, technically, as you increase the voltage, you are anticipated to observe an increase in current. However, the band in these nano regimes actually prevent flow of electron and cause the current to come down. So this is an example of a negative conductance device. This is also a very important solid state device where actually negative conductance can come, which shows that you can actually have bistable devices or bistable applications or logical devices based on the same kind of phenomenon. Actually, at your level, I think you will be learning about tunnel diodes. This is an example of a classical example of a tunnel diode, actually. So it actually happens basically because of the size of the intermediate material between the P and N junction, which allows this tunneling of electrons between across bands, presenting this kind of IV characteristics. To understand, see, in order to understand actually this diagram, to understand how tunneling is possible, or how much of difference in energy is actually required for pushing, you need a very sensitive equipment, which is actually called as a Kelvin probe. This is a Kelvin probe that my research is actually going on. It is actually called as scanning photovoltaic Kelvin probe. Only using the Kelvin probe, you can actually measure the work function. Now, actually, if you remember, work function is the amount of energy which is actually required to pull your electron out from the material. That is, it has to be out of the material, but not free of the material. That is, it is in the vacuum, but is not out completely free. So here, this for different materials, for different kinds of materials, you will have different work functions, and this Kelvin probe actually enables you to measure this work function. My work is going on this. At least I think one or two more years of work is required on completing this equipment. Another kind of solid state device is actually like if you can design materials which are sensitive to gas sensing. This is again a kind of solid state device that we designed in my lab. This is actually like this is actually a copper.
Sorry to interrupt, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, CPT is not moving, sir.
Not moving.
Scrolling, yeah.
Yeah, this is actually a gas sensor diode that actually we designed based on Sirius. Now, this is the kind of surface that we see. But if you look at this, for the forward bias voltages, it does not respond to gases. But the reverse current actually shows a different response to different gases. So again, if you look at it in the band level, the presence of gases could actually cause bending in the bands. In the conduction band, it can actually cause the bending of the bands, which actually leads to sensitivity of the diode to a particular gas. This again, we have published in, I think, 2018. Yeah, this is again a different kind of surface actually, which enables, this is the kind of surface of a particular material, I think, yeah, that is again CDS actually. Now, if you look at this kind of surface, in such surfaces, the effect of light on the photocurrent is actually shown here. That is, when light falls on the material, there is increase in current. So such kind of materials actually are very very much important in all kinds of optoelectronic devices to make sensors actually. And again, this is actually on zinc oxide, where again, if you see again the structure, based on how the surface structure is, the current, instead of rising continuously, automatically falls, and then when light is switched off, current decays. This again, this was published just recently, where we actually photosensitivity. Actually, it is giant photosensitivity, where I think the sensitivity is about 10 raised to 8 is the sensitivity, which means that if the current actually increases by around 10 raised to minus 7, right? If you calculate in the order, if you say it is 1 milliamp in the dark, it goes down to around 1 pico. Yeah, from 1 pico ampere to 1 milliamp was the actually increase in current in the structure when light falls on it. So this is actually what I wanted to show in these slides is that the kind of band structuring, which comes from the surface nature of the material, actually results in different kinds of electrical response from these materials. Now, the core of this material, or for a solid state device, would be this banding here. How this band is aligned is how ultimately the device actually performs. Now, one of the most, this is the one about carbon, right? Now, all of us are moving into graphene and all. So it is actually how these states intermix among themselves, rather when it is in the usual form of as it is in the form of a carbon, or when it is in the form of graphene, or when it is from the form of graphite, or when it is in the form of graphene. How these bands bend determine the kind of electrical properties that can demonstrate. I think I will stop here, and I would take up any of these doubts anybody would have. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I think I'll take up doubts. If anybody has any doubts, I can take up a few doubts.
Okay, sir. The session is open for questions. If you have any questions, you can post it in the chat box so that it can be addressed.
Participant need your PPT, sir.
Yeah, hello.
Ah, yes, sir. We are audible.
I guess nobody has any doubts. It has been completely messed up with a lot of interruptions, I guess.
Sorry.
They want your PPT, sir. They want your PPT to be shared. Yeah.
Yeah, no problem. I've sent you. You can share the PPT. No problem.
Yeah, sure. Participants, please feel free to ask questions.
I think because I've not adapted to technology properly, I have not been able to fully make you understand. That's what even I understand.
Sir, I have few words to share with you.
Yeah.
Actually, your presentation is like a crash course on the band theory.
Yeah.
From the basic, you have covered the synthesis of your materials also. It was very interesting. And those students of first year B.Tech engineering, we have second semester as material science. And now it is renamed as engineering physics too, where we will be dealing with band theory of solids, energy gap, electron moving from lower energy level to higher energy level. And then those students of first year B.Tech, they must understand now you have a lot of applications beyond all this band theory now. Research at a lot of wonderful applications. Now, I hope so those students, they are learning all these theories with some applications. Okay, and now one more thing to share with you, sir. Can you say any evolving opportunities in this field for the younger generation?
Sorry, can you repeat? I didn't get that.
Any opportunities of research in this field, sir?
Yo, the potential is huge, actually.
Please share the tips for the younger generation, sir.
Okay, see, I will tell my personal experience. I am basically like a BSc Physics and an MSc Physics graduate. Then I did my PhD. But see, the thing that I learned when I joined the industry after my PhD, the industry has huge demands for actually technologists out there. Basically, the semiconductor industry is actually seeking people with new knowledge. Once you get into the market, basically once you get into the industry, you will understand the actual potential. Like from R&D to production, everywhere you need people who have some kind of knowledge on, say, primarily today the industry is on some kind of knowledge on silicon, but people are slowly moving away from silicon also. But people who understand processing and people who understand the electrical transfer properties, they are in huge demand. For example, now people are speaking about only artificial intelligence, but understand that to make artificially intelligent instruments, you need to have sensitive devices. So you need to have sensors. You need to have multiple kinds of sensors. You need to have sound sensors. You need to have light sensors. You need to have gas sensors. All these sensors are solid-state devices. Now everybody is talking about AI only in terms of programming. Nobody's concerned about the hardcore level of a particular sensor of picking up this information. That is where actually there is this mechanical engineers or your electrical engineers, that is where they have some huge scope to come in. Because today the sensitivity is very poor. So if you say that, look even at your camera, the mobile phone that you have, you say that your mobile phone has night vision camera. Now, how does the night vision work actually? It works basically on the sensitivity of a diode there. The photodiode has to be sensitive enough to pick up light even in darkness. If you can engineer materials which can actually be more photosensitive, you can make good cameras. It has nothing to do with the software behind it. It has everything to do with hardware there. So the hardware industry is actually dying for more and more technologies. You every day people call me up saying, asking me, sir, do we have technology for this? Do we have a technology for that? As a science follower, what I feel is that we have a lot of science in our hand, but we don't have the technology to do. That is what I actually feel sitting in my lab here. The potential is very huge. A lot of microelectronics industry is out there. Even GE is recruiting people. IBM is recruiting people. They want people with the knowledge on these backgrounds. It is not only the software engineers who actually are getting employed. I guess.
Yes, sir. I think the last one, what you stressed, it's really useful. Because nowadays we are talking about the transformation of science into technology. I think this particular topic is very, very much important in the field of technology, right? Especially the, as you said, many concentrate on AI, but nobody concentrate on the devices, right? So I think that was an excellent point given by you. I would also like to have some questions here. In any means, flexible electronics lose quality to solid state devices.
Can you repeat the question? Your voice is actually breaking up.
Flexible electronics lose quality to solid state devices.
Okay. Flexible devices is in today a good area to research in. Basically because one is that the transporting and the other is the efficiency. Now solid state devices, the same solid state device that we are trying to make, we simply change it to a substrate, into a substrate which is flexible. So once you make it on a flexible substrate, only the transport properties actually change. It is not the quality which is changing, it is the transport property. Or if you say it is the electrical property, the conductivity, how does it change? Now, when you talk about, say, for a simple example, let us think about sensor. You have a solid state sensor, which is basically your camera today. Your camera today is absolutely hard. You cannot imagine rotating your or bending your camera to take a photo, right? Once the substrate is capable of bending, you can actually twist your camera and take the photo from a very different perspective. But still, the solid state device would be the same. I hope the idea is clear. You understand, it is basically a PN junction. The PN junction is deposited on a substrate which is flexible actually. It is not, so how the substrate varies will actually control the electrical output of that PN junction.
Yes.
So it is the same PN junction but on a different substrate, and only that has to be optimized. So flexible electronics is actually tomorrow's future, because all of us are wanting everything to be kept in our pockets, right?
Yes. Correct. Yeah. So I think you have done really excellently well, sir. Like this is what I wanted to ask you, but you naturally entered into the technology, because as science people, we are more concerned about the concept. But transforming the concept into a reality can be done only by a technologist. So that should be a better understanding of science concept to bring everything into reality. So I think that was really excellent. The answer you gave was really excellent.
Thank you. So this is what actually I suffer also, because though we have science, as I said earlier, we have a lot of science at hand, but making a product, we have not been successful making a product with any of these. Now that is where actually that's why I told about Chandra about Bose. Though he took a patent, it never came out as a product. Somebody else came out as a product.
Mm. Okay,
one more question, sir. One more question. This will be the last question. It was posted by Kamachi Rajshekar. Sir, could you please share some information about density of states?
Yeah.
Okay. Here, if you look at the band bending there, then the say 1s, you would take 1s2 states. Now, when you take this 1s2 states, now how many number of atoms come into that position would control the density there? I'll talk about it in a mathematical way. Now, just imagine an equation which says that capital N is equal to small n into small p. Now, one of the interesting questions that anybody can ask you is, if you dope a material, say silicon, you dope a material to p-type, what will be the net charge on the material? Now, the normal question, a normal answer that anyone would come up with, since you have doped it with a p-type material, the net charge would be positive, right? So students will always come and tell the answer as, say, positive charge. Now, this is never going to happen. See, basically, because the n is equal to n into p says that you dope a material as n-type, what you're doing is basically you're removing the p-type there. That is n and p is always a constant. N into p is a constant. For silicon, if you say it is only 1 into 10 raised to 10. So 1 into 10 raised to 10 is equal to small n into small p. So you dope it n or you dope it into p, this 1 into 10 raised to 10 is never going to change. That is where actually silicon is limited also. You can dope it to 10 raised to, say, n doping, you can do it up to 10 raised to 15 per centimeter cube. And p doping, you can do up to 10 raised to 22 centimeter cube per cube. Now, when I say the centimeter per cube is where actually this density of states actually come into play. So, which means that the maximum density of states for an end doping can be 10 raised to 15 per centimeter cube and 10 raised to 22 for pre-doping. So how this states n into p, since it is 1 into 10 raised to 10, the shells or these levels, that is your 1s, 2s, 2p, 3s, 3p, they will interact with each other to obtain a certain potential differences between them. That is where actually your final device configuration comes into play. Like you can have very high mobile devices, like HMET, high mobile devices, where what happens is the density of states is very high. It is at the top, 1 into 10 raised to 10 is where it is actually reached. You cannot go beyond it, where the mobility is the maximum. So in such materials, the charges would show the maximum mobility which is feasible. So density of states actually controls the flow of current through the material, which can be designed based on this mathematical equation. I spoke only with relative to silicon actually. For other materials, this equation will actually change. I think you would have understood something.
Good evening, sir. I am Professor Uday Kala from Dr. NGR Educational Research Institute. I am a chemistry person. Is it audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, all this band theory, everything is about the electron shift. Am I right? I am a chemistry person. That's what I'm asking. So, yeah. Is it possible to work?